Next up is a distinguished scholar and academic, a gentleman whose research interests include the applications of artificial intelligence to fields such as engineering, computer science, finance, and medicine. He's currently the Vice Chancellor and the Principal of the University of Johannesburg. Please welcome Professor Tshilidzi Marwala.
Sanbonan. Dumelang. Awusheni. No, thank you very much for inviting me to come and talk about the fourth industrial revolution opportunities, and I'm going to add threats. Now, before I get into what I'm going to talk about, I think I need to define what the fourth industrial revolution is all about. Because it is actually a controversial subject, in the sense that if you go to Japan, they say we are in society 5.0. Basically, the fourth industrial revolution is defined as an era that is a consequence of what happened in the first industrial revolution, in the second industrial revolution, in the third industrial revolution, and now we are in the fourth industrial revolution. In the first industrial revolution, man actually started using machines for production, and it happened in England in the 1700s. And it happened in England because of what is called scientific revolution. And for those of us who are students, we remember the names Newton. Newton's laws of motion is what we study in matric. That was actually the catalyst for making the British the first people to industrialize. Then we came to the second industrial revolution. Again, for those of us who are paying attention in our school, we study a subject called electromagnetism, where every time you see a magnet, you can be able to generate induce movement. And whenever you induce movement, you can generate electricity, which is really what how we generate electricity and create electrical motors. So in this era, mass production of goods and services came about. Because now we could be able to move things using electricity. Then the third industrial revolution was about electronics, writing things with ones and zeros. And of course, what electronics did was to automate communication with ones and zeros. Before then, we used to communicate with ones and zeros. We used to have something called a telegram in our post offices, where you will go and send a message and somebody will be switching a switch on and off, and somebody on the other side will be able to translate that switching on and off into ones and zeros, and those ones and zeros were translated into a message. Of course, when we had the transistor, which is a revolution that happened in the United States, now we can be able to automate that. And that is why we have computers, and we have our smartphones. And of course, the electronic age has really defined our era. Now we are in the fourth industrial revolution. This is an era in which technology is becoming more human. If you had come when I was born, I can reveal my age. Despite my youthful look, I am 50 years old. And when I was born, you couldn't speak to a machine. A machine could not be able to hear you. You know, why can machines be able to hear you today? It's because of the developments in a technology called artificial intelligence. But 50 years ago, artificial intelligence was around. In fact, the term was coined in 1956 in the United States. What has happened is that now we are able to industrialize this technology. So the fourth industrial revolution is an era where our biological being is being fused with machines. And that fusion might actually be actual connection, but it can also be psychological. For example, many of us, when we wake up in the morning, the first thing we do is to look into our telephones, our cell phones. And the reason for that is because human beings and machines are fusing to become one system. Now, how did I get into this area called the fourth industrial revolution? I actually studied engineering. I studied mechanical engineering. But before then, my first engineering teacher was my grandmother. My grandmother could not read or write, but she used to make clay pots. And I used to accompany her in this clay pots making, I will call it industry. It might not have been scaled up, but it certainly was industry, and she would go and sell these clay pots. And the clay pots are made from clay. You get clay from the river, and I will accompany my grandmother into the river. And of course, in engineering, we call that material selection. You have all sorts of softwares that allow companies to be able to select the appropriate materials. For example, if you are designing a car and making a car, of course, there are many choices of what material you're going to use, depending on the required strength. Even when you are making drones, there is a material selection part of that. After that, my grandmother will come back and form that clay into a pot. And of course, now we have sophisticated fourth industrial revolution technology called CAD, you know, computer-aided design, that will help you make the appropriate pot where it is not too thick, you know, to make it difficult to heat, but not too thin to make it easy to break. So my grandmother will be able to design all these things without the CAD program. And then after that, she will go and put it in the sun so that it can dry. And after it has dried, she'll put it into the fire so that it can be hardened. And of course, for those of us who work in material science, we'll know that hardening of material, whether through the annealing process, which happens quite a great deal in the steel industry, is still something that is very important for industries today. And after that, my grandmother will knock each pot and listen to the sound. If the sound is long, it's a good pot. If the sound is short, it's actually a bad pot. And of course, this is what we call detection of cracks and non-destructive testing. The reason why we call it non-destructive is because you are testing it by hitting it, not hitting it hard enough so that it will crack. Otherwise, it will become, you can always find out fault by breaking things apart. But here you are doing it through listening to this sound. And now, because we are in the fourth industrial revolution, this whole technology of listening to things and be able to determine whether they are in good conditions or not are actually at the core of the fourth industrial revolution. One of the projects that that I have learned from one of my former PhD student, who did former master student who went to Oxford to do a PhD, is when doctors look at listen to the sound of your body with all sophisticated devices, listening devices, heart rate, you know, and so on and so forth, your breathing sound, and be able to take that information into a computer with an artificial intelligence engine, and the computer is able to tell you whether that person is in good condition or not. Now, one of the areas that is completely being changed by the fourth industrial revolution is what is called radiology. Radiology is a field of medicine where doctors look at an X-ray image and be able to tell whether a person is actually in good health or not. And now what we are finding out is that artificial intelligence is able to look at those images and make a diagnosis better than a human doctor, with all sorts of implications on how we train a doctor. Now, what are some of those implications? The doctor of the fourth industrial revolution age must also be able to understand technology. Another example is monitoring of structures, very similar to what my grandmother has done. We can apply the same technology to our cars, where a listening device does not have to listen to the sound. It can also sense the movement of the engine, the vibration of the engine, and be able to take that information into an artificial intelligence machine, and it will be able to tell you whether your car is in good condition or not. The same procedure is applied to monitor our bridges, you know, in our roads, to monitor quality of our roads with cars driving over roads and studying the profiles of the road and using artificial intelligence to actually grade whether the road is now ready to be fixed or to be redone, and or if it is not ready, when is it going to be ready, so that you can be able to plan and budget. Now, all these things that I have said actually talks to one thing. What is the role of a human being in the fourth industrial revolution era? If many of the things that we are doing can be done by a machine better than a human being, what is the role of a human being in this? In fact, what is the future of work? What is going to happen to the future of work? What is going to happen is that some jobs are actually going to disappear. And it's not for the first time that jobs are disappearing. In fact, I am told, I was not there because I'm not that old. I was told that 60 years ago, when you used to go to a building, there used to be somebody who was employed to operate a lift to take you upwards. Because that process was complicated. It involved weights, putting weights and removing weights, and so on and so forth, you know. But today, because of automation that came through electronics, now when you get into a lift, you yourself do it yourself by pressing where you are going. Of course, now with things like pandemic, you can be able to instruct a lift where you are going by voice, saying, I'm going to the fifth floor, or I'm going to the sixth floor, you know. So that job of somebody who used to manage a lift is gone. There are no adverts of those jobs. They no longer exist. So some jobs are going to disappear. The doctor that we are going to need today is going to be a doctor who understands technology. So some jobs are going to change. And these changes will entail the fusing of technology with traditional skills, with all sorts of implications on how you choose your career, what you study, what we teach, and so on and so forth. And then the third part that is going to happen, new jobs are going to emerge. And many of those jobs, we do not know. I am a vice chancellor, the outgoing vice chancellor of the University of Johannesburg. Now I am going to become the rector of the United Nations University in Japan. So, as an educator, my big question is, how do I educate people so that they are going to adapt to this new reality that some jobs are going to disappear, many jobs are going to change, many jobs are going to emerge? How do I educate somebody without actually knowing which jobs are going to disappear, without knowing which jobs are going to change, without knowing which new jobs are going to emerge, so that the person who comes from my institution is actually fit for purpose? Of course, for those of you who have studied advanced mathematics, you will know this is what we call game theory. How do you act not knowing what is going to happen? Now, some of the elements that we have introduced is actually what I call multidisciplinary education. Those who are studying science and technological subjects must also study human and social sciences. Those who are studying human and social sciences must also study science and technology. Because if you are going to be an engineer who has been given a task of designing a speech recognition tool, it goes without saying that you have to, at the same time, be able to understand linguistics, language? How can you be able to design a speech recognition tool if you do not understand language? Now, if a computer scientist, who is somebody who is supposed to design this speech learning tool, has not been exposed to languages with all their complexities, structures, textures, and so on and so forth, then they are going to be left behind. And of course, and the example of drones here, that has been eloquently said before, where it is being used to inform people, you know. Again, it involves an engineer, but it also involves somebody who actually understands what society needs, you know, and multidisciplinary education will actually make that engineer respond better to what the society actually needs. So, at the University of Johannesburg, we have actually introduced few concepts in order to give our students multidisciplinary experience. The first one is that all our students have to take a course called Artificial Intelligence in the Fourth Industrial Revolution. The course does not teach you how to code. It's a literacy course, you know. And secondly, all our students have to take a course called Africa Insights Module, so that they understand African politics, African economy, and African society. And the reason for that is because these technological spaces are actually invading all aspects of our lives. I personally studied mechanical engineering at an undergraduate and master's level. And when I went to do a PhD, that is when I actually studied artificial intelligence. Now, one of the most powerful artificial intelligence algorithm is something called reinforcement learning. How do you teach a computer or a machine learn through, call it punishment and reward? It's actually called reinforcement learning. And when I was an undergraduate student in the United States studying mechanical engineering, I was asked to take human and social sciences. And one of the subjects that I took was psychology. And when you study psychology, one of the concepts that you study is reinforcement learning. It starts with a Russian psychologist called Pavlov, who used to feed his dogs and ring the bell, feed his dogs, ring the bell, feed his dogs, and after a while, whenever he rings the bell, the dog starts behaving like they're hungry, you know. And the reason for that was because the ringing of the bell has been reinforced. And now when I came to artificial intelligence and I learned about reinforcement learning, it was not a new concept. It would have been a new concept if I did not study psychology. If you look at electronic maps, shortest distances between two points, the way ants actually move in our homes, and sometimes you see them forming straight lines, is actually the shortest distance from their nest to where the food source is. And that whole concept has been turned into an artificial intelligence algorithm called ant colony optimization, and is actually applied in electronics maps. So, in conclusion, because I can see the MC is here and is about to take me off the stage. In conclusion, what should you study so that in this new era that is actually emerging, you are not left behind? My advice is that it really does not matter what you study. What matters is that you have to ensure that in whatever you study, you should infuse your training with multidisciplinary content. And secondly, that you do well in whatever you are doing. Because the problems that we are going to face as industries, as societies, as countries, are going to be so complex that they are not going to be solvable if people are unidimensional. So I thank you very much. Niyabonga. Bayadanki.